women. So we will let the women speak to the women and encourage them and then strengthen them. Amen. Oh, I don't care. Amen. Amen. If you are not ready for the word of God, everybody's face is busan. Hallelujah. Amen. Rejoice in the Lord. You should be glad in the Lord. You should be happy that you have the opportunity to be in the house of the Lord. If we know the blessing that is in it for to be in the house of the Lord, we will always bless his holy name and we will always rejoice for being in his presence. Amen.
Amen.
So without wasting much time, we will call upon Apostle Robin to lead us in this level of preaching.
Administration, please come. Amen. Amen. There was a song in my heart. I know y'all been singing. I know y'all know it. Yes. Shekinah glory. Yes. Shekinah glory. Yes. Shekinah glory. Amen. So Mavis, Sister Linda, Mama Cecilia, come. Joyce, Sister Joyce. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all know y'all knew it. Come on, come on. Amen. Amen. And also, when we sing. Okay, and also, Mother Cecilia, we're going to have her sing a song as well. Amen. So let's go ahead and let Mama Cecilia just start off singing the song. Amen. Come on, women. Come on up. Amen. Amen. So Mother Cecilia, you can come on and lead us in a song. And then we have Sister Joyce just lead us in a nice song after Mother Cecilia, whatever the Lord put on your heart. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
In the title of my song this morning is Master Speaks. It's a Catholic song, but I don't know if my head is in that. It goes like this.
Master, speak, thy servant heareth, waiting for thy precious word, longing for thy voice that cheereth. Master, let it now be heard.
Issues, but thank God that we will have those fixed on Sunday. So thank you, women, for still want to step up.
Okay.
Oh, hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring crying.
Amen. Happy Mother's Day to you beautiful mothers. Amen. Can all the mothers just stand up? Amen. Can all the mothers please stand up? Amen. What's going on today? Today is Mother's Day. Brother Eric and Brother David, y'all can stand up in place of y'all wives. Come on, stand up. Amen. Come on. Today is Mother's Day. Amen. 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 Today is a special day. Amen. Especially to our first mothers. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
I'm so glad. Jesus.
bless God because I said yes, but Shekinah Glory, they also sing Jesus. And I believe that even, you know, in what the Lord has given me on today, amen, just to talk about Moses and his mom, amen, that she had to call on the name of Jesus, amen. Even when she put him, amen, in that nice wetted basket and sent him down the Nile River, amen. She had to call on the name of Jesus, amen. But I believe also in that song, which we all know, amen, she also had to say yes to it, amen. Amen. She had to say yes, Lord, and trust in the Lord and call on the name of Jesus. Amen. I just want to say happy Mother's Day to you beautiful mothers out there, mothers to be. Amen. And all the grandmothers out there, God bless you also. Happy Mother's Day. We first of all want to definitely say happy Mother's Day to the first lady of this house, Belinda Ezamore, all the way back, amen. So we bless her and say happy Mother's Day to her as well, amen. Amen. So we just give God the glory and the honor just being here on today on Mother's Day, amen. Amen. It's just an honor just to be before you as your family, amen. Amen. But I believe that even on today, it's more than just a sermon on today. It's to encourage us mothers, amen. It also is a word to say that even as mothers, that you have done a great job in mothering those that God has entrusted you to, amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I come to you and I humble myself before you and I ask you, Lord, to decrease me that you may increase, that your word shall come forth and go forth and fall on good ground, that your people will receive a word from you. Allow the Holy Spirit to dwell on my tongue as I speak, that, Lord, it will speak with power of demonstration. And, Lord, we give you the glory. We give you the honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Before I go into my sermon, I'm not going to be before you long because I know you have something very special planned for the wife, your wives and mothers, amen. So we're not going to be here long so we can go forth and enjoy the rest of this beautiful day, amen. But I do want to just share a word with you. And I just want to talk to you mothers on today. I remember just looking back some years back here about, it's 10 years now, wow. Didn't know like it was that long, amen. You know, because when you understand life and death, amen, you understand that, you know, that when you lose your loved one, they're no longer here, amen. But you give honor where honor is due, amen. So on the day that my mother passed, I did not realize that that was that day, amen. But I thank God that I can stand here today and to be have overcome even in her death and passing, because I understand life and death. But I do honor her because without her, I wouldn't even be here on today. Even though I know I was a thought and that was mentioned before the heavens and the earth, but it took my mother, amen, for me to be here because it was the seed that was in her womb in order to allow to birth me through the matrix in order for me to come out and be here and standing before you today. So I thank God that God have healed me in that area. And for those that may not have your mothers, I just wanted to encourage you as well to let you know that all is well. Amen. And that God continue to touch you even on this day. Because a lot of individuals is having a difficulty, you know, celebrating Mother's Day because they're no longer having their mother. But I want you to know that this is a day of celebration. Amen. Because they're gone to what? A better place. A place that we're striving to get to. Amen. Which is eternal life. Amen. So, in other words, I would also want to encourage those mothers to let you know that are here. Because we have a mother, amen, here. She's not here, but her husband is here, Brother David. They are newly parents, amen, new parents, amen. And also just a miracle son, amen. Sometimes you talk about that because a lot of times people really don't understand a miracle, amen. But when you can see that little boy, he's just like a little man. I mean, like, no difficulties, no nothing. But it's just an honor to just be here and to see that miracle, amen. And for the mothers that have birthed more than one and two, amen. 4 and 5, amen. And Brother Eric is on 6, amen. So he done passed grace, amen. He's going over to favor and all that, and wealthy and large and coast and territories and things, amen. And we got sister Linda, amen. On three, amen. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. And Mavis with the two, glory to God, amen. My God, mother, my God, daughter, who preaching with me. She's always preaching, y'all. I know y'all here in the background. You need to come in here on Friday nights because she be in here praying and singing as well, amen. She has it in her blood already, amen. May God be the glory. But most of all, those that are the pillars of the church. We never should forget our mothers of the church. Amen. Those are the mothers that help hold the church up. Amen. First as Belinda, as Amore, and then our mothers. Amen. Sister Cecilia, Mother Cecilia, Mother Felicia, and Mother Victoria, who is not here on today. We honor you for being mothers of this church. Mothers with wisdom. Mothers that are unique. Amen. And you play a crucial role in our lives here at Unlimited Grace Prayer Ministry. Amen. So I want to share with you as mothers, God has given us a special gift. That special gift is our children. Amen. The special gift is our children. Amen. Motherhood is not a chore. Amen. It's not an unpleasant task. Amen. It's not something that we regret. Amen. Now, okay, you know, you look back over your, I can speak for me. You know, my children are 25 and 23. And I can remember back then, I used to be like, Lord, I need your help. But guess what? It's not a regret. Because when I look at them today, I thank God that he gave me the strength to help raise them. See, I never took it upon myself to say, I raised them, amen. I always knew that it had to be the Lord. You know why? Because I have two boys. It's no way I can raise a man. I'm not a man, amen. I'm a woman, amen. So it had to take the Lord to help me raise my sons, amen. So I thank God that he did not allow me to think that it was a chore or an unpleasant task, amen. But it was something that I loved to do, amen. Even though I was firm, even though I moved in authority, but I had to because I wanted to make sure that they was led in the right direction. But I had to learn how to move out the way. Come on. I had to learn to allow God to fight my battles and to help me raise my sons. Just as mothers bear a child during pregnancy, and just as a mother feed and care for a child during pregnancy, so does mothers also play an ongoing role in our life, in their lives of their children, whether they are still babies, adolescents, teenagers, young adults, even older adults. Don't you know when you have children, it does not end? Amen. You still have to take care of your children. I asked Pastor the other day, I said, so you say that I still got to pay some bills for them? I thought they supposed to be paying some bills for me. I'm just saying, amen. But we still supposed to take care of our children. Now, not be a hindrance to our children, meaning doing things that they really need to do because they need to learn what responsibility. But we should never allow our children going in need. Amen. So for y'all that have smaller children, I'm here to let you know. You better get to work in some longer hours. Amen. And get ready to save up some money. Because when them children get older, them bills going to get larger. Amen. Amen. But they do take care of us. Amen. I can't wait to at the church. I got two big gifts. Amen. See, I look forward to Mother's Day, my birthday, Christmas, and just every day because they always give me a special gift. Amen. But as a mother, we know motherhood is a role. Amen. It's a role that is developed to love, care, to nourish, and to encourage as a mother. Amen. And guess what, mothers out there? It never ceases. We must continue to care. We must continue to love. We must continue to comfort even when our children get on our nerves. Amen. Amen. Because guess what? Our children gonna get on our nerves. Amen. Now, we may not think that way, but I remember my son when he was a baby, he was a crybaby. Amen. So he cried all the time. He didn't want nobody else to hold him but me. So that got on my nerves. Amen. Come on, y'all. I'm just trying to help y'all, mothers. Amen. Mothers, y'all also have the availability, amen, to care and nourish and comfort them in the morning, in the evening, and in noonday. Amen. We must continue to be involved with our children. When we are involved with our children, amen, as mothers, amen, not just natural mothers, but spiritual mothers, amen, we must learn to interact. We must learn to discuss things, amen. Because see, Brother Eric, your son, he's getting into that teenage year, amen. So he's going to want to discuss some things with, only he can discuss with you. Because sometimes young men want to discuss things with daddy, amen. They don't feel comfortable discussing things with mama, amen. Even little girls sometimes want to discuss things with daddy because they know us as mothers would be like, girl, what you saying? What you doing? Not while I'm living, amen. But daddy's to be a little easy on them and say, okay, did you ask your mama? Let me talk to your mama. Let me see what I can do. See, come on, y'all. I know y'all know what I'm talking about. Amen. And inner involvement is processing things. Amen. To put together. So, guess what? Mothers and fathers, you're going to have to process some things. You're going to have to come together. Because them children going to try to play y'all against each other. Amen. They're going to come and ask daddy first. And then they're going to come and ask mama. And then they're going to try to see who say yes and who say no. And then whoever say yes, they're going to be moral on a yes. And they're going to get the one who said yes to get the one who said no to say yes. So, that's how they're going to try to process that situation. Amen. But we as parents must learn to talk with one another and come up with the best solution and agreement so that it will not only benefit us, but it will benefit our child well-being. Amen. That brings balance. Amen. But children will do that. Amen. We also must continue to teach our children scriptures. Amen. We must continue to raise up our child the way that they're supposed to go. Amen. Eric, could you get us, please, Psalm 78, 5 and 6. Amen. Psalm 78, 5 and 6. As we continue to teach our children, amen, the word of God, and teach our children how to live like Christ, I believe that even if they fall astray or they fall to the wayside, that they are going to come back to reality. Amen. Because as we raise our children the way that they should go, the Lord will bring them back. Amen. But children will try to go to the left. Amen. That's just life. Amen. Children have a journey that they must go down. We have our own journey. Amen. Even though I did not have a girl, I had two boys, but my one son, he reminded me so much of me. So I had to go back and reminisce and think and say, now, I used to be 22. So therefore, when I was 22, I was still a little immature. I was still trying to play the game. So I have to at least be a little lenient on him and allow him to live his life. But at the same time, long as I know that I have given him the instructions and the ingredients to do the right thing, I had to learn how to move out the way. Amen. See, sometimes we still try to raise our children as boys when they're a young man. So my prayer was, Lord, teach me how to raise young men because they're no longer boys. Amen. Amen. I'm going somewhere because where I'm going in the word of God, I believe Moses went through this same type of training. Amen. But the good thing with Moses is he had two mothers. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Go ahead and read that for me, Minister Aaron. Psalm 78, 5 and 6.
For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers, that they should make them known to their children. Amen.
Amen.
That is how the Father is. It is torn out of my Bible.
Amen. See that? Amen. We got verification and confirmation. Glory to God. We're on the same page. Amen. We got to line the word of God up to what we're saying. Amen. 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 I just love you all. Also, as mothers and what we have discipline. Amen. Discipline. Because we have to teach our children to fear the Lord. Amen. We need to go to Pastor Joe. Could you please go to Hebrews 12:5? Amen. We must draw the line for them to be, we must be consistent. We must be firm and loving. Amen. It's okay to be nice. But see, the thing is, we can't try to be a friend to our children. We are friend with them, but we can't be a friend to them because then they begin to take advantage of that. We must first learn how to be, first of all, mothers. Amen. See, sometimes we get lost because when we're in ministry, instead of us being mothers first, we are pastors, or we are the evangelist, or we are the teacher. We forget about the first role is being a mother, being a wife. Amen. So you can't really be in ministry and miss that lineup. Amen. You first have to be, if you're married, a wife and a mother. Amen. See, it's hard for your children to relate to you if you keep coming off to them as just the pastor. See, they want to see the mother. See, these are things that I'm telling you because these are things that I experienced with my children. They love the fact that I was saved and I was doing the work of the Lord, but they miss that Robin. They miss their mother. They miss the times, the fun times. They miss the time when we go to the mall. They miss the time when they were able to buy me something and I would love it, but now it's like, no, I need my skirt to be down to my feet. I need to be closed up. They like, Mom, wait a minute. Exactly. But I had to learn how to be a mother first. Amen.
Amen.
It says, and you, Hebrews 12:5, and you have forgotten the exaltation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when they are rebuked of him. Amen. 6, please.
For whom the Lord loveth, he chastiseth and scoureth every son whom he receiveth.
7. Keep going to 11, please.
If you endure chastising, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chastiseth not? 8. But if ye be without chastising, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. 9. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of the Spirit and life? 10. For they verily for a few days chastised us after their own pleasures, but he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness. 11. Now, no chastising is for present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Amen.
Amen. Pastor, when I go to the last point, go to Titus 2:4, please. Again, that was talking about the discipline. Amen. We must have discipline because God, he chastised us as well. Amen. And the last one is nurture. Nurture means to provide an environment of constant verbal support. Mothers, we have to continue to verbally talk to our children. Even as babies, we must continue to say, Gaga, goo goo, mama, love you, amen. As they get older, we must continue to verbally talk to them, encourage them, let them know that they are more than conquerors. Let them know that they are beautiful. Let them know that they can do anything in life if they reach out and go forth and go forward and strive for it. We must continue to encourage our children because, see, it is the voice that they hear from us that pushes them into their purpose and their destiny. But when we discourage them and speak negative, they become that. Amen. So we must learn to continue to speak positive to them. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. We must continue to let them know not to fail. Amen. That freedom to fail is unacceptable. Amen. We must allow them to know that they've already been accepted in the eyes of the beloved, that they are already loved by our Lord Jesus Christ, but most of all, us as their mother. Amen. We must show unconditional love. That is that agape love. Amen. I'm talking about that love when they get on your nerves, that love when you know they done did something wrong, but you can still leave them and say, I love you, and hug them and love on them. Amen. It's something about my youngest son. He act just like me. And I tell you, sometimes when we get together, I'm so happy to see him, but he always know that he pushes that little red button. And by the time I leave him, I'm fussing and I'm saying, oh, you get on my nerves sometimes. But at the end of the day, before I leave and before we depart one another, I'm being real, y'all. Before we depart one another, I just grab him and I just tell him I love him. Amen. Because I want him to know sometimes we may not agree. Amen. Sometimes we may disagree, but that don't take away the love that I have for you. And one thing that he let me know, he said, Mom, I just need you to listen to me. Mom, I need you to know that I'm not a little boy anymore, but I'm a young man. So sometimes how you come off at me, it seems like you still think that I'm a little boy. See, that's that open verbal communication. Now I understand how he feels. So my prayer to God is, God, help me learn how to talk to him as a young man and not a little boy. Amen. That is part of nurturing our children. Amen. And in Titus 2:4. Amen. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 halves that mothers have. Amen. That's availability, involvement, teaching, training, discipline, and nourishment. Amen. And nurture. Amen. Titus 2:4 say that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children. As mothers at the church, that's what they do. They teach us young mothers how, come on, to be good. Amen. To be obedient. Amen. Hallelujah. How to treat our husbands. They teach us these things as being pillars of the church, mothers of the church. Amen. Because they have already experienced these things. So therefore, the mother wisdom is the best wisdom that you can ever have. But at the same time, that journey that we must go down, some of the things we don't have to go through, but it's a journey that we have to go to. But a lot of things with the wisdom from our mothers, we don't have to go through those things. Because when I think back and just think of the things that my mama used to tell me, if I could have just took some of that wisdom and took some of that knowledge, some of the things that I went through in life, guess what? That wasn't part of my journey. But because I was hard-headed and I was a stiff neck, I had to go through those things. But I tell you, when I think about them things, I say I had a good mother. She was wise, and I thank God for her. And I wish that I would have listened when she was here. But now that she is gone, I can take those same nuggets and share it with another young lady and pray and hope that she will take that wisdom and apply it to her life. Glory to God. It's something about mothers, y'all. Mothers, that was the only way in the way that all of us have gotten here. Amen. It is our womb, amen, that bring forth the baby, amen. I don't know no man that had no baby, glory to God. I know it's only women, amen. Come on, mothers, I'm about to talk about us for a little while, because they don't understand the pain. They don't understand that birthing pain. They don't understand, see, when it ain't just about giving birth, that type of pain, but it's the pain that we go through during the process, amen. It's that pain when our body begins to change, y'all. Come on now. Especially when you used to being in the 10, and now your body, you in the 16, you like, oh Lord, and I may not get back to that 10. So we go through things psychologically, emotionally. Come on, somebody. So it ain't just pushing that baby out of the canal, but it's about going through some physical body changes. Come on, y'all. See, you may can't get back into that dress that you wore last year, or even those shoes, but sometimes our feet get swell. Come on, y'all. I know you know what I'm talking about. Even just going through pregnancy is not easy. Amen. Amen. Because it's also it's a process between life and death. Some people don't make it through pregnancy. Some people come out with high blood pressure. Amen. Stress. Amen. We as mothers got to worry about, is our child going to come out with all their limbs? Come, I'm not saying you fathers don't think about those things, but see, us mothers, because we mothers, we so worried. See, we are emotional. Come on, I'm helping some of these mothers in here. So, husbands, when your wife is emotional, it's okay, because mothers, we are emotional. Amen. We are emotional beings. Amen. But being pregnant is a process. So just imagine Moses' mother. She went through this process of going through these things. And down the line, through the grapevine, she heard about a decree. A decree is saying, coming and killing all the sons. My God. Now, when we give birth, we're looking at it as a bundle of joy. To experience, to hold them, and to love them, and to cover them, correct? We can't wait to get out of delivery. Because all we got in the front of our mind, in the back of our mind, I can't wait to get and hold my baby. Amen?
Amen.
So just imagine, even though she had that little time, but see, she had to not only be able to think about the time to cuddle with her baby, but because the decree went out, she had to think of other options in keeping him alive. See, it's a difference when you can just see how I'm going to go home and put my baby in the crib and fix up the room and paint the room. Then somebody to say, now I got to build a basket and send him down the Niles River and pray to God that the alligators or no other. Come on now. So we're on the same page as mothers. Amen.
Amen.
So as we go to the book of Exodus, I'm not going to be before you long. Give me 10, 15 minutes and I'm telling you I'm out the door. Amen. Because I done already gave you a word of encouragement. I done already preached. Now I'm going to give you some application and revelation in the word of God. And we're going to praise our way up out of here. Is that okay? Glory to God. But in Exodus 2:2-15, it says, and the woman became pregnant and bare a son. And when she saw that, I'm coming out of the Amplified Bible, amen. And the woman became pregnant and bore a son. And when she saw that he was beautiful, she hid him for 3 months. And when she could no longer hide him, she took him from an ark or basket made of bulrushes of papyrus, dabbed it with bitumen and pitch. Then she put the child in it, and she laid it among the rushes by the brook of the river. And his sister Miriam stood some distance away to learn what will be done to him. Now the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the river, and her maiden walked along the bank. She saw the ark among the rushes and sent her maid to fetch it. When she opened it, she saw the child. And behold, the baby cried. And she took pity on him and said, this is one of the Hebrew children. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call a nurse of Hebrew women to nurse the child for you? Amen. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go. And the girl went and called the child's mother. Glory to God. That right there is the miracle. Then Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child away and nurse it for me, and I give you your wages. So even though she took him and put him away, put him down the Nile, come on, y'all. She's now getting a second chance to be able to cuddle with that child, y'all. Be able to probably, I'm kind of paraphrasing, just kind of making it real how we today as our mothers, she can go and paint that room, come on, blue. She can make the bed real nice, come on. She can spend this nice quality time with her son, amen. Even though now she know that she's going to still have to get rid of him, but at least just give her that little time with him, amen, hallelujah. So as he grew, amen, the Pharaoh's daughter said, take the child and nurse it for me, and I will give you wages, glory to God. Now when God can pay you for raising your own child, come on somebody, when that means you ain't got to rush and go back to work, and God is paying you for taking care of your own child, I want that job, Lord. Amen. Glory to God. So God already had another miracle in the process. Amen. She getting paid for taking care of her own son, who she done gave birth to. God is a miracle. Oh, Lord, glory to God. That right there already done preached it. Glory to God. So the woman took the child and nursed it. And the child grew. And she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter. And he became her son. Now, come on. This is a blessing. When you don't live with your biological mama, now you don't live, come on now, in Egypt. Come on now. Probably in a low place. Now you about to go to your second mother. Come on. Now you going from the pit to the palace. Glory to God. Now he about to go live in luxury. Amen. See, God had a plan for Moses. He couldn't just understand just how to live down in the rut. Amen. But he had to also know how to live in high places. Amen. Because God already knew that he was going to be a deliverer. So anytime you are a deliverer of something, you got to know all the angles. Glory to God. Because you're going to deal with people all types of walks of life. So God was already preparing him from childbirth. See, that's what God do. Know that God provoke us into purpose. So do not take those things that you went through in your childhood as something negative. Know that those things that happened to you when you was a child, it had to happen in order for you to be here today, in order for you to walk in a place that God is allowing you to walk in. Because there is something about a testimony about your test. Because when you don't have a testimony or be able to have no revelation or demonstration or anything else that's going to be able to come on and back up your story, it's going to be hard to minister to somebody. Glory to God. God gonna give you a little way to minister, but when you got something where you can come out of Egypt, come out of a low place, can go into a high place, and then find yourself at the burning bush, glory to God, with nothing and starting over, glory to God. Y'all better catch this, because God is dropping it on us right today. Glory to God. So the woman took the child and nursed it. He grew. She brought him to Pharaoh's daughter. He became her son, and she called him Moses, for she said, come on now, he was even, come on, being raised without a name. Glory to God. See, one thing about God is he'll take your name and make it great. See, you don't have to worry about your name, because God will always make your name great. See, we get caught up in the names, but don't look at who the person is in the inside. See, God knew that when he created Moses, that he was already going to be a deliverer. See, he didn't have to be named at the time of his birth. He didn't have to be named during the process, because God already knew that his name was, first of all, that the deliverer, glory to God. But he had to go ahead and put something natural on it, because we only understand natural names. So that's why he named him Moses, glory to God. So as he was called Moses, why? Because I threw him out of the water, glory to God. Meaning that I took him out of the water. One day after Moses was grown, it happened that he went out to the brethren to look at the burdens. Now he's grown. Now he's able to see. His eyes is open. He's able to go back and even get some revelation from his past. Because see, his mother raised him. See, his mother raised him from the beginning. So that means that she began to nurture him. She began to give him what he needed. She began to give him his background, his culture, where he come from, his foundation. So that's something that can never leave you. I don't care where you go. But when you are grounded in your culture and your foundation, that is something that you hold on to. You don't forget where you come from. That don't mean that you stay there. You just don't remember where you come from. So when you go into another place, you would know how to interact and help those that came from that same foundation that you came from. So I believe as Moses was here, he had he began to reminisce. He had a what they call that? He had a black flash. He had a flashback. Glory to God. Something hit him like, wait a minute. This is where I come from. I can't allow this to go on. Glory to God. So as he began, as he grown and happened, he went out to his brother and looked at the burden he saw in Egypt beating a Hebrew. Come on. That's one of Moses' brothers. Come on, I'm in the Word. Come on now. That was the foundation. That's where he come from. Come on now. When we see one another, we getting beat in the spirit. We begin to go in and pray and fast. Glory to God. When we see the devil beating us up as brothers and sisters, we go and we prostrate and we lay before God. Come on. We begin to shout down and all that good stuff for our brother. I believe that this is what Moses did. But he only knew how to do this in the natural. nostril. So he began to use his hands and beat him because he was beginning to be trained spiritually. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So because now he had to commit a crime. Amen. He had to commit something to get out of the palace so that he can start into his purpose. Because he already had it all. So therefore, how would he would get out? So he had to do something that was against the law of where he was. Glory to God.
Amen.
God provoked us into purpose. And that's what happened. He got provoked into purpose. He looked this way and said, and that way. And when he say no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. See, he was equipped. Glory to God. See, don't you know as a little boy, while he was in Pharaoh's house, don't you know he was looking and seeing how they went to war? Come on. He saw how they would kill people and hide them. He ain't just thinking this that day. He grew up into this. He knew this. So that's why it was so easy for him to do it. But see, somebody was looking. Amen. I believe that person was put there on purpose. Glory to God. See, when God got purpose on your life, he would do something on purpose to get you into your purpose. Glory to God. So I believe that when he went out on the second day and saw the two Hebrew men crawling and fighting, he said to the unjust aggressor, why are you striking your commander? This is just what I believe. Amen. Who made you a prince and judge over us? Come on, y'all. Do you intend to kill me? Amen. As you killed the Egyptian? Amen. Then Moses was afraid and thought, surely this thing he knew. When Pharaoh heard of it, he sought to slay Moses, but Moses fled from Pharaoh's presence, took refuge in the land of Midian, where he sat down by a way. Amen. I believe that he got learned how to flee from his mama. Amen. Because his mother had to flee. Amen. His mother had to get him out the house so he wouldn't be what? Slain. Amen. So she flee with her son. Amen. So he had some type of background from his mama. Amen. So he knew how to get out and get to where he was going. Amen. So I just believe that even in that time of his fleeing, he did not know exactly what it was that was going to go on. But I believe as he began to have flashbacks, glory to God, God began to lead him into the place where God began to call him to. Amen. But I believe that he had to go through the training because where God was taking him, he knew that the type of people that he was going to deal with, he had to have went through every type of situation in his life to be able to be that leader of those children of Israel, glory to God. Because the children of Israel, they were some stiff-necked, hard-headed, disobedient children, glory to God. They was ungrateful. They didn't even realize that God brought them out of Egypt, out of the promised land. They were still complaining. They were still crying. They was just ungrateful, glory to God. But I believe as Moses led them, Moses began to think about his mother, glory to God. Began to think about how she weaving up that basket and how she set it up and how she thought the process through to be able to flee with him. So when they came, glory to God, they would not have slain him. And I even believe as she sent her daughter to look and see who would take him, I believe that even when the daughter saw that it was God that began to say, yes, 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 Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. It was her mother that began to say, Jesus, 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 I need you to work into this right now. I believe that she began to pray. I believe God even began to think about all the good things that his mother did, even while she was pregnant with Moses, how she was a mother, even to marrying her for his brother. Glory to God. I believe that he looked at her being a nurturing mother, her being available for her children, her doing what she needs to do for her children previous before Moses. So God granted her the opportunity and said, there's no other mother like you. So you gotta raise your son, Moses. And I believe that that was that miracle that God even called her back to be able to nurse her own son and to get paid for it. Glory to God. No longer did she have to walk in fear Archer had her son, but she was out in the open making money, raising her children, and to know that her son will grow and be the deliverer, glory to God, of Israel. This is something that we must say as mothers. When God can give us something, he can give us something great. He can entrust us with his children. Those children don't belong to us, but God entrusts them to us because he trusts us. He knows that we got the love and that we will nurture them. We will protect them. We will do all we can for them, and that he will even bless us with more. When God is able to trust you with his children, glory to God, because he loves his little children. He's not going to let any and everybody raise his children, but when he can trust you and you and you and you, that is a gift from God. So that is another gift you can add to your plate, huh? Being able to bear children, being able to raise them up. But his mother, she had the ability to raise her son, get paid for him, and watch him go through the process, even after she gave him back. See, there's only so many times in years as a mother, the time frame to be able to set that foundation, and that's in the birth, and then up to the stages. Once you set that, can't nobody come in and change it. So mothers, that's what we got, being able to set the foundation of our children. Nobody can come in and shake it or remove it from underneath them. So she had the opportunity to do just that with her son. So we thank God that God has given us that same opportunity. We thank God that God has even given those that's looking to marry and to bear children that opportunity. Amen. So in my closing, I want you to understand something. I want you to understand that even in these passages of scriptures that I have read to you, that it's always a miracle. It was a miracle. It was a miracle that God allowed Moses' mother, amen, to raise her son in spite of the decree that was sent out, and to get paid for raising her son, amen. It was a miracle that he was able to be raised by two women, amen. The woman in the palace, the woman of Pharaoh's daughter, amen. He was able to learn both cultures. He was able to learn both ways of living, amen. 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 He was able to learn how to fight, amen. Because I believe Moses being a baby, he would have been spoiled. But in Pharaoh's house, he learned how to fight. Amen? Amen. So in closing, I just want you to know, mothers, you are great. And the Lord have blessed you with some beautiful children. And the Lord have blessed you to be wise to your husband. Continue to be the mother that God have called you to be. Know that sometimes it may not be easy. But if you rely on the Lord and trust in the Lord and ask the Lord how to raise your children, how to be a great mother, how to be a great wife, how to be a great grandmother or aunt, he will do it. All you have to do is ask. He said you have not because you ask not. So whatever trouble that you have, just trust in the Lord and continue to be available for your children, involved with your children, continue to teach your children, train your children, discipline your children, and nourish your children with unconditional love. In Jesus' name, may God bless you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And on behalf of the ministry, if we can call out the mothers to the forefront, please. And David and Eric, if you all can come up in place of your wives. I know they're not here today, but we want to make sure that they get what it is. So if all the mothers can come up, please. And father's mothers. I'm going to call y'all.
Quick.
Oh,
mothers, Mother Felice, Mother Sue. Okay, we got Jerome. He's gonna help.